Okay, we are almost ready to get started. Sue Cox is here selling tickets to next weekend's ping pong event. So that is going to be a fierce competition. Fierce. In fact, on the other side of this wall, people who probably should be in Bible study are playing hooky and practicing ping pong in the youth room right now. So I think this is going to be very competitive. This is going to be a fierce contest. So let Sue know if you want to buy tickets. Okay? How much are they? And they go towards, it includes dinner, and it goes towards the youth who are fundraising for their trip to Houston, the LCMS youth gathering, which takes place every 3 years. Okay? Ah, hi, Diane. Okay. Do you want the mic or? Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay, so Doug Munt is home now. And we have been praying so hard for Doug. Oh, really? Yeah, he needs his rest. Tonight. Wow. Okay, but so today is the wedding. Okay, so Fred and Diane Munt's daughter, Marie, is marrying Chris Golden, who is has won multiple awards in the music industry. He is the son of the Oak Ridge boy with the long, long beard. What's his name? What's that Oak Ridge boy? William Golden. Okay, so that's pretty cool. And I always thought that it's interesting that the Munts are from Oak Ridge, Tennessee, and Marie is marrying the son of an Oak Ridge boy. So, and I actually have tried to investigate this mystery, but there's nothing more to it than that. It's just a coincidence. So we're very, very happy for Doug. Doug has come a long way in the last few months. It was on a Wednesday during Lent when Doug had a terrible accident, and so many of his bones have been broken. But he's been in the hospital, and he's had setbacks, and he's been to a couple of rehab places, but now he's doing well enough, he's strong enough, that he's able to come home, and he even flirted with the idea of coming to church today. So we are just thrilled for Doug. Thank you for all your prayers. I'm speaking on behalf of Fred and Diane right now. Thank you to everybody who have been so prayerfully supportive of Doug and Leslie and their whole family. Also, I'm very happy to introduce to you some guests. Now, before I came here to Crossville, I was serving a church in the city of Tonawanda, which is tucked between Buffalo, New York, and Niagara Falls. So it was just about a 20-minute drive from my driveway at the parsonage to Niagara Falls. And in that area, there's actually three Tonawandas, totally independent of each other. You have the town of Tonawanda, you have the city of Tonawanda, that's where I was, the city of Tonawanda, and you have North Tonawanda, but we're all just right there on top of each other, and there's a multitude of LCMS churches in the Tonawandas, and the pastor of St. Mark's Lutheran Church in North Tonawanda is here with his wife. This is Pastor Keith Knupp and his wife, Shelley. And I really had not spoken a whole lot to Keith since I came down to Crossville, but I was delighted when a few weeks ago he called me and said that he would be driving through town. And so yesterday was that time. And so after the service yesterday evening, the Canups and me and my family, we had pizza at Brocco's, Kevin and Christy's place. And it was just a really, really good time. And it was nice to be with some friends. So friends that we hadn't seen in quite a while. So very glad to have you with us. They attended the service last night, but I coaxed them into coming to the Bible study this morning. So very, very glad. Do we have any other guests that would like to be recognized? I'm not seeing. No? Okay. Tomorrow morning, I'm leading a discussion on infant baptism. Anyone is welcome to come. I have tons of materials. You will be given those materials. I think it's going to be a good conversation. I'm trying to think of other announcements. Did you just call me Herr Pastor? Oh, Herr Pastor. I think in the gathering place. I think in the gathering place, yeah. Okay? Any other? I feel like I'm missing. We've already announced about the ping pong tournament. Okay. Also, we have a special request. Somebody has asked that we pray this morning for the safety and the protection of our Supreme Court justices. As we know, this is a very tense time because of things that have been coming from the Supreme Court, and we just don't want anybody to get hurt. On either side of that debate, we don't want upheaval. We don't want rioting or arson or anything that is unpleasant in our nation's capital or around the country. And we certainly do not want anything unpleasant or undesirable to happen to any of our Supreme Court justices. This is a very unique time in history, and we just have to pray that the Lord protects us from all of that. Also, we want to pray for continued healing in the wake of that terrible business that happened at a Tops in Buffalo. Just defies comprehension, and we hate it when those kinds of things happen. So let's just pray that our land would be delivered of all that kind of nonsense. Almighty God, we thank you for our country. Many of us are daily concerned about our country because there is so much division, and there is upheaval, and there's a lot of anger, and there's a lot of threats being made out there from both sides. And these are things that dispirit and discourage us, Lord. At the same time, we do believe that you care very much about our country and that you are governing in your divine way the events that occur for us. And we just ask that you would bless our nation, that you would deliver it from senseless, stupid, worthless violence and carnage, that you would use our government in order to manifest a world that is just. Lord, we also pray that our country would have laws that are very, very protective of life at all stages of development. Lord, we also pray for the protection of our government officials in the executive branch, the legislative branch. And lately, we are a little bit more concerned about the judicial branch because of things that are happening in our Supreme Court. Lord, we worry for the safety of our justices. And so we just pray that you would surround each of them with your holy angels, guard and protect them, and keep them from suffering the violence of those who cannot control their impulses. And we are offer this prayer in the most holy name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Okay, so what we have been doing since Easter is talking about the stages of the Lord's exaltation. So now we have, you know what those stages are because we've gone over it again and again, listed very conveniently for us in the Apostles' Creed. He descended into hell, right? It begins with his descent into hell. That's where the stages of exaltation begin. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. We talked about that last week. Sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence, he shall come again to judge the living and the dead. So that's where we are this week. And to be honest with you, depending on how today goes, I might be really open-minded about what we do next week, because we're making tremendous progress. So maybe for the last 5 minutes, we could discuss what we want to do next week. And then Pastor John, after next week, will be teaching Acts of the Apostles on Sunday mornings through the summer. Okay? All right, so you have a handout. And what this is, I've given the community workshops as a way to be out in the community. I have at times offered workshops in the community pertaining to a particular theological topic. And so in the past, I have offered workshops that were well advertised and well attended on the Lord's second coming. So for our purposes today, and I had a really, really hard time deciding what to take off, but I just did a condensed version of that workshop. And you could tell I really, really struggled what to keep and what to let go. But why don't we begin with the passage that we studied last week for the Lord's ascension, because they go hand in hand. So that's in Acts chapter 1. We're going to look at verses 6 through 11. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority." So get used to uncertainty, right? "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." So, I don't know, you can disagree with me, that's fine. I always thought that when it comes to the Lord's second coming, at least in terms of a visual, this selection from Acts is very, very useful. You watched him go up, and in the same way, he will return again. Okay? And so that's why I use that same picture on the right there of the Lord's ascension, because the two men in white robes said, just as he ascended, he will return. Okay? All right. So now let's look at a list that I myself made. You can disagree with it. I love it if you do. Trust me, it's fine. That's how theology works. But this is my list of things that we know for sure regarding the Lord's second coming, and then hopefully we can get some significant dialogue going, so don't be shy. All right, first, Jesus will return from heaven bodily, okay? So, Jesus gives himself to us constantly in the life and in the ministry of the church, there is no doubt. And Jesus is bodily present to us in the sacramental ministry of the church, right? But his bodily form, though given to us, is also hidden from us visually. In other words, some of you may have noticed, is it on this cheek or this cheek? I have a mole right there, right? Which cheek is it? Is this cheek? It's the other cheek, right there, okay? I have to be careful when I shave that because I could hurt myself. That skin is a little bit more delicate than other parts of my face. But anyway, it's a physical feature that is unique to me, right? The way my eyebrows are, my cheekbones, my height. There's all kinds of things that we could, you know, if I were wanted by the police, right? They would try to come up with a description of what I looked like compared to other people, right? Well, Jesus also had physical features that you and I are not privy to. Now, those who knew and encountered Jesus during his earthly ministry, they knew if he had a mole or how long he wore his hair or what his walking gait was like, or groomed his fingernails were, and how he liked to wear his sandals, and all, you know, things that are unique to him. I think he must have looked very, 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 very normal, because the Gospels do not give us any kind of explanation of what he looked like. Unlike, say, Saul in the New Testament, we are told that he was the tallest person in Israel and the most handsome. Okay, no such comment is made about Jesus. So he must have just looked really, really average, just like anybody else, as prophesied in Isaiah 53. But here's my point. Even though we receive Jesus bodily through the sacramental life of the church, we do not encounter him so that we can apprehend him with our eyes in the same way that the apostles and Jesus' own contemporaries did. But when he comes back, then we will see him, his beautiful Jewish, Nazarene, Galilean self, with all that implies. We will see him in his bodily form, okay? This is how he will make himself known to us. Although resurrected, and we talked about that when we discussed the resurrection a couple of weeks ago, we talked about how there's something funny going on there, because he's not immediately recognized, and somehow he appears in rooms, yet he still eats food and all this kind of stuff. So he still has his wounds, right? He can be touched. He's not a ghost. He himself says that. So there are, we can assume that having gone through death and having experienced the glory of the resurrection, he is different, but it's his same physical Jewish Nazarene Galilean body that was knit and formed in the womb of the Virgin Mother, okay? So when we see him, we will see him as he appeared at his resurrection, okay? Any thoughts or questions about that? All right. The Lord will come in glory, accompanied by innumerable angels. Now, as we go through this list, which is Pastor Andrew's creation, okay, as we go through this list and we tick off these things that Pastor Andrew thinks that we know for sure, that's me, by the way, there's a multitude of scriptures I might have used, and there are times when I do use more than one scripture, but for brevity's sake, I only just use one in order to justify my thesis, okay? So the Lord will come in glory, accompanied by innumerable angels. So we see that in so much of what Jesus prophesies himself, such as in Mark 13, you might say, but also in Revelation and in the writings of Paul. These things are consistently asserted. The whole world will see and recognize him. Okay, so I don't really understand quite how that works. I think that that's very mysterious. But in Matthew 24, it says, "For as the lightning comes from the east and shines as far as the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man." So he will come in bodily form, with hands, feet, elbows, eyelashes, a particular way of speaking, things that are unique to his humanity. At the same time, he will be presented to the whole world at once. So any thoughts about how we sort that out? So if, I'm not saying that Jesus' contemporaries believed that the world was flat, but if they had a much narrower view of what the world was, say it was like a flat disc, like a pancake, and that it wasn't as big as it truly is, that you can almost see how the ancient church believed that he would have come down in this dramatic way so that everybody who was on the pancake could look and see and behold him. However, that's not really what the world is, right? The world is round. So how do we sort that out? Look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 7. So is by the way, is what George said something for us to consider? Well, because of cell phones and news networks and television and the internet, that's how we will all behold the second coming of Christ? Is that valid, Mike? Yeah. Okay. All right. Very good. All right. But look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 7. "Behold, he is coming with the clouds." By the way, whenever you hear about Jesus returning on the clouds or with the clouds or riding on the clouds, that is an immediate reference to the book of Daniel, which describes the Son of Man coming on the clouds. So much of Daniel informs the theology of the New Testament. Okay, so Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, "Behold, he's coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen." Okay? So it's very difficult to understand or to visualize what this may mean, but Jesus is coming, and when he comes, all will see him and know him. Okay? All right, so the next one. "We cannot know the day nor the hour of the Lord's second coming." Mark 13, verse 32, Jesus said, "But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." Now, it's very mysterious that the Son should be excluded from something that the Father knows. There's a couple of ways we can approach that. One, the Son in his humanity, and the Son in his humility is lesser than the Father, as it says in the Athanasian Creed. And so does not necessarily, well, Jesus in his humanity has two knowledges, right? He has a human knowledge and a divine knowledge. So this could be a nod to his human knowledge, or this could possibly have Jewish wedding connotations, okay? As you know, Jesus is so many times in the Gospels, in the Epistles, in the book of Revelation, Jesus is referred to as a groom, and the church is referred to as the bride. And I personally believe it is valuable to us to understand Jewish wedding culture, Jewish wedding customs from the first century, because that helps us to understand so much of what Jesus said about his relationship to the church, but also in terms of the end times. Or I shouldn't say the end times, I should say his second coming. So like in Matthew 25, you have the 10 virgins, right? Five with oil and five without. and they don't really know when the bridegroom is coming. So it's a complete mystery to them. And some of them preserved their oil well, and some did not. So some were wise and some were foolish. And then it says at midnight, the bridegroom came with a procession, and that threw the foolish virgins into a panic. So that's just one example of how knowing Jewish wedding customs can help inform much of what the New Testament says about the second coming of Christ. Or if you want to think about the Last Supper in the Gospel of John, where Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you, and when I go, then I will come back and take you to where I am. Again, this is all very connotative of first century Jewish wedding customs. The bridegroom would go to his father's house and prepare a place for he and his bride to live. And when that place was completed and the father gave approval to it, then the son would go and claim his bride. But nobody knew at what point the father was going to be satisfied with the groom and would give his son leave to go claim his bride. So there are different ways that we can look at that idea that nobody knows, not even the son, but only the father. All right? Any questions or insights into that? Or does anybody have more knowledge about that kind of thing that they'd like to share? Jody? Well, I think that it's, I hate to be this harsh, but it could be kind of a sinful arrogance for people to say that they know, that they have an insight into the scriptures so that they can determine right down to the second when Jesus is going to come. And of course, we know that this happens almost every generation has someone who claims to know that Jesus is going to come, but as we can see, they've been wrong until now. I find a healthy tension between two things, though. One is that Jesus, you see the Latin on the front of the page? I always put something in a language like that just to create suspense and to make it look cool and sophisticated. So that Latin at the beginning is from the fig tree, learn a lesson, parabolum, learn a lesson from the fig tree. So that's from Mark chapter 13. Jesus is saying, pay attention to the fig tree, because when the figs are ripe, you know that summer is coming. So it's a little confusing to me that Jesus strongly urges his church to pay attention to the signs. When you see this happening or when you see that happening, then you know that it will be soon. But then he says, but no one knows the day nor the hour. So it's almost as if somebody smarter than me can probably explain it better, but it's almost as if Jesus is saying, pay attention. And you'll see when it's about to happen, but you are going to be so surprised. you know, it's like it's one or the other. Is that a good way to say it? Or a both and? I shouldn't say one or the other. It's a both and. So Jesus charges us to stay awake. There's a multitude of parables about that, or things that he says in his Olivet Discourse. Or in other places, you know, keep your eyes open, stay awake, watch for the signs from the fig tree, learn a lesson, but nobody will really know the day nor the hour. Okay, so does anybody have any thoughts about how we sort that tension out? Anybody? Linda? Yeah, but still he encourages us to watch for the signs. let me, I want to make sure we have the right vocabulary too, so I'm going to draw something on the board. So do we understand our vocabulary, Beth? I think that that's a really good metaphor because the school year just seems to last forever, right? Right. But then when you get to that part where everybody knows the end is drawing near, there's just a completely different kind of spirit in the world, in the classroom. Debbie and then Linda. Debbie. So Let's take a vote, though. Just for giggles and kicks does not mean a thing, but let's just take a vote. How many people in this room are willing to say, I don't know for sure, but I think we're in the little season? Do it higher. Some of you are like, okay. All right, how many are saying, no, not at all? Really? There's a few people that say, no, not at all. How many are just comfortable saying, how do I know? Okay. Okay. All right. Yeah, Linda. Well, yeah, but I mean, don't forget, you know, St. Paul in Ephesians, you know, he says, you know, we're contending with spirits of a different realm, and that is where the real war is. So to what extent are the unfortunate events of the day really being governed and influenced by the powers of evil? Mike? Yeah, that's true. Right. So do you think the way that the world is changing so rapidly, I mean, the world has always changed, but like this? Like this? Really? That's right. Yeah, and I think that's part of the little season shtick, that towards the end of the end times, there will be increased deceptions, and people will be persuaded to abandon the faith. Jesus himself said, if possible, even the elect. Shelley? Very interesting. Very interesting. Do the evil powers have more insight as to when these things take place than we do? Okay. All right. Oh, it doesn't say anything about the angels in hell. I see where you're going. Okay. All right, let's keep going. At his second coming, Jesus will judge the whole world. So let me just give you the straight up catechetical answer to judgment. Okay, there are two judgments. There is the judgment as soon as you die. And then there is, so that is an individual judgment. And then there is the general judgment at the resurrection of all flesh on the last day. How you are judged when you die is how you will be judged at the general judgment. Okay? So it's not as if you're going to be judged this way when you die and then judged differently at the general judgment. No Christian should fear being judged at all. As St. Paul says, and we'll get to this in a minute, but as St. Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we'll get to that here in a minute. But as your pastor, I forbid you to fear judgment. If you fear judgment, I am doing something wrong. Okay? You should be 100% confident that you will be judged according to the innocence of Christ, and that you will not be judged according to your sins. If I'm not doing a good job imparting that critically important doctrine to you, then you should immediately fire me and hire Keith or Mike. Mike? Absolutely, yeah. That's right. Right. Well, and right, but right. And the devil is working on us 24/7, creating doubts within us. Did God really say that? I mean, that's what he said to Eve, right? Did God really say that? Well, every Sunday, God speaks to you in the absolution of his called and ordained pastor. In the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That is just the very same as if God, in his awesome, thunderous, divine voice, were to shout it from heaven to you directly, because that's how Christ uses his church to distribute his gifts, which are certain. But because the devil works on us, and because sin gnaws away at our sin, we do live in chronic doubt. And so that is why we have, you know, St. Paul said in the letter to the Romans, faith comes by hearing. We have to keep coming back in order to be given that message of the gospel, which is the power of God for the salvation of those who would believe. Okay, so just real quickly on judgment. Yes, Janeth. Well, you know, that's why St. Paul, in both in Romans and in Galatians, he just waxes on and on about Abraham. You know, in Genesis chapter 15, verse 6, the text says, Abraham believed, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Well, that is like, that's like the most important concept of the Old Testament to the apostle. He said, Abraham believed that God can bring something into existence that did not exist. Abraham believed that God would make him the father of nations, even though he was 100 years old. And Paul says, you know, if you're 100 years old, when it comes to bearing children, you're as good as dead. But and Sarah, his wife, was barren. But Abraham believed, and God counted it to him as righteousness. So St. Paul would say, if we believe that God can do, if he could save us who all fail in the Ten Commandments, we all fall short of the glory of God, then it is counted to us as righteousness. We believe that God can do what he says he's going to do. Yes. Right. That's why it takes faith. Which is St. Paul verbatim. He was it. And that's why the promise rests on grace. Okay. Oh, Keith. You're not getting my job. I was just kidding. I was just kidding. No, I'm teasing you. I'm sorry. right. Small called articles. Forgiven those who trespass against us. God always keeps his promises. And it's good for pastors. You know, pastors are the ones, they speak in, what would you say? First person, no, second person, plural. I forgive you your sins. Well, you know, I remember asking pastors years and years ago, I said, so when I say that to the congregation, does that apply to me also? And the consensus in the room for that particular conversation was, yes, good, that's wonderful, I need it. But still, it is a tremendous gift when a pastor hears it from someone else. So I love and I cherish it. Pastor B about and I, we switch off liturgical duties. We're really enjoying doing that. It's been a great way for us to exercise our liturgical ministry here. I love and cherish it when I get to be the listener rather than the speaker, because again, faith comes by hearing. That's what the Apostle Paul said. That is how the Holy Spirit creates faith in our hearts. Faith comes by hearing the word of Christ. Okay, let's move along. Thank you, everybody. All right, halfway down the page. For repentant sinners who believe in Christ, his return will be a blessed and glorious event. Okay, so we actually want Jesus to come. We're not fearful of it. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I've come to I prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you also may be. So keep in mind, what the Christian wants more than anything is to be with Jesus. And here we have the word of Jesus himself saying that I will come and bring you to where I am. That's what we want. Revelation 19, the angel said, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Okay, again. Just to be with Jesus is the deepest desire of the Christian heart. For those who are unwilling to repent and believe, Christ's return will be terrifying. So John 3, verse 36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Or Second Thessalonians, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels, there we go again, always there's this association with angels, with the Lord's second coming, in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, they will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might. All right, next, what should I call these? Theses? Satan will be definitively and eternally vanquished, okay? And when the 1,000 years are ended, Satan will be released from his prison. I'm not going to read this whole thing, but if we want, we can talk about millennial issues, not millennial in our modern use of the word, like the millennial generation, but theological disputes over a supposed millennium, either before or after the coming of Christ. We'll see if we can get to that. Okay, all things will be made new. And he who's seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." At the second coming, the former things will pass away. Again, from Revelation 21. Look at just those last words from that paragraph. I have it in bold print, italicized. "For the former things have passed away." Death, sickness, sin. And then, of course, it is a fundamental truth regarding the second coming of Christ that Jesus never really left us. In Matthew 19, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them," which is what Pastor Keith was saying just a moment ago. Or at the end, the last thing Jesus says in Matthew 28, "I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Jesus is always with us. Or in John 14, "I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. Yet a little while and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. In that day you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, "Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus answered, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him." Listen to this. "And we will come to him and make our home with him." And then in Hebrews chapter 7, "Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them." Okay, so let's, I'm sure there's lots of other things I could put on a list of things we know for sure, but for our purposes this morning, I like what we have. Okay, the next section, should Christians fear the second coming of Christ? Romans chapter 5, verse 9, "Since therefore we have been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God." Listen to that. "Since therefore we have been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God." In Romans chapter 8, I already referenced it, but just to do it again, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Or in Luke chapter 12, "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." And we already looked at some verses from John 14, so let's skip to Hebrews 9. "And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes the judgment." So, you know, I was talking about how there's two judgments, okay? That's the catechetical answer. There's a judgment when we die that's personal and individual, okay? Why do we believe that? That's what Scripture teaches. We're getting ready to look at that. But then Scripture also teaches that there will be a general judgment on the last day, all right? So let's look at what Scripture says about the judgment when we die. "And just as it is appointed for a man to die once, and after that comes judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time." Okay? His second coming. "He will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him." Okay? So any questions about that? Any comments? Anything at all? All right, so let's have a little fun with some extra stuff. So you hear a lot, especially here in the Bible Belt, about a pre-tribulation rapture. This is the idea, but very common, that before the bedlam of the little season, God will swoop up his elect and they will be spared tribulation. But we believe that that is an erroneous belief, especially because Jesus repeatedly prepares his followers to suffer the tribulation. So what is pre-tribulation rapture? Pre-tribulation rapture is a false, unscriptural doctrine popularized in the 19th century, teaching that Christians still alive will be removed from the world before the tribulation of Satan's little season. The idea comes from a misinterpretation of the words caught up in 1 Thessalonians 4:17. The word rapture derives from the Latin word rapio, which is used in the Latin Vulgate for the Greek word harpagio, but taken out of its immediate context in 1 Thessalonians. Let me see if I can do this. Harpago. Anybody? Mike, say it louder. Harpago semetha, which means will be caught up. The doctrine is false because Jesus repeatedly warns that the church will share in the suffering characterizing the little season. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Okay, so what is millennialism? All right, so this is not my writing. This is something I think I cut and pasted off the internet. Premillennialists believe that Christ will come back before his 1,000-year period to establish what is called the millennial kingdom. Okay? Postmillennialists believe that the 1,000-year reign will be ushered in by the preaching of the gospel as nations and institutions are formed along biblical guidelines and as the world becomes predominantly Christian. The worldwide acceptance of the gospel will usher in a spiritual reign of Christ through the church, and he will return when the 1,000 years is up. According to postmillennialism, the 1,000 years mentioned in Revelation 20 may or may not be a literal number of years. Amillennialists, that's me, and I hope that's you. Amillennialists believe that there will be no literal 1,000-year kingdom. Amillennialists generally believe that the number 1,000 is symbolic for perfection or fulfillment, and that Revelation 20 speaks of the current age in which we live as Christ reigns in the church and in the hearts of his people. According to amillennialism, Satan is currently bound in that he cannot hinder the preaching of the gospel as Christ builds his church. All right, so I would have to understand more what is meant by that last sentence. But for your convenience, turn to the last page. You have a diagram. Okay? I don't really want to go through it line by line. We don't have time to do that anyway. But these are different understandings of the sequence of things. So you have the era of the church. You have the second coming of Christ. You have notions of 1,000 years. For some people, the idea of 1,000 years precedes the second coming of Christ. For some people, it's after the second coming of Christ. The Lutheran Church Missouri Synod and your pastor does not buy into that. The final diagram at the bottom of the page is what we believe as a church, and that is that we are already in that 1,000-year period. Again, it's metaphorical, and then, which is the end times. And then right before the second advent of Christ, you have Satan's little season where there will be all kinds of havoc and upheaval and all kinds of things characterizing. Christ will come and inaugurate definitively the resurrection of all flesh and the new creation, a new heavens and a new earth. Okay? Any questions about that? Nothing else? Any thoughts about what we might do next week? Anybody at all? We pretty much went through the stages of Christ's exaltation, so I have an extra Sunday to have pure fun with. Wait a minute, is there going to be a Bible study next week because of the ping pong tournament? All right, so we will have Bible study. Does anybody have any thoughts? All right. I'll come up with something. Carol? Okay, go ahead, Carol. Okay. Well, I don't know, but just real quickly, in 2 Peter, the apostle says to the Lord, a day is 1,000 years and 1,000 years is a day, or something like that. So you have to keep in mind, from the divine perspective, the concept of time could be very much different from our own. Okay? All right. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is